I got some in the car.
You have lotion?
All right, we'll go ahead and get started. Good morning, everybody. We can get some people to get in their seat.
I'm sorry.
What are you doing?
Around.
No. You sure?
Hey, no, that's the spitting row right there.
Hey, listen. Good morning. Beautiful day, man. And the Lord's so good to us. Let's just open our hearts up and worship Him. Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for this day. And we just thank you for your blessings. Thank you for your love. And just thank you for your mercy. And Lord, you're so good to us, and we just thank and praise you for that, and just pray that we'll open our hearts and minds up to you, and just let you come into our hearts, and just let the Holy Spirit work in us, and Lord, just pray for us in here lost today that they've come to know you, and we love you, and thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Please stand. We're
going to
worship in song together.
Light of the world, you stepped down into darkness.
Good to see everybody this morning. Ladies did good this morning, huh?
Yeah,
boy. All right. I want everybody to stand up. I want everybody to be happy in this place.
Yes.
Turn to the person next to you and say, I love you.
I love you.
Turn to the person behind you and tell them you love them. Shake a hand. Greet somebody. Hey, you ain't hugged on my boy. Where's Marcus at? He need a hug.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, let's pray real quick while we're standing up, please, and we'll get into the message. Dear Heavenly Father, just thank you this day. Dear Father God, just thank you for what you do for us. And I just pray that open hearts and open minds hear the message today, dear Father God, that you'll change our lives forever. We just love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen.
It's good to see everybody this morning. We got some visitors. And I didn't get to shake your hands. It's good seeing y'all. And but hey, y'all feel good today?
Yes.
I'm telling you, the Lord's done something. I'm telling you, he's doing something. The Asbury Revival's still going on. I think it's the 11th or 12th day. It's spread to Lee College, going to other colleges. And people's driving from all over to America to be at that revival. And they said the lines is 3 or 4 hours long just to get in it, be a part of it. But see, I see God moving in people's hearts locally, changing and doing things that I've never seen before. He's changed me in the last 4 weeks. I'm just telling you. He's carried it to another level. I'm tired of seeing the bad things happen. But we got to tap into God's real power, his real strength, and be who we say we are, right or wrong.
Right.
Now, some of us is living on both sides of the fence, and it ain't going in well for you. You young people, I'm telling you right now, y'all have a chance to do something amazing in this country. Y'all got the backbone and the power source and get God behind you to do it. See, I'm tired of seeing people wrapped up in drugs and alcohol and sex and all this other stuff. You know, back when I was growing up, a little child, you didn't use the S word. But guess what? It's there now. It's in the grade schools. It's in the high schools. It's in the middle schools. It's all over. That's what we see on TV. So there is a big God movement going on. And I forgot to tell Michelle this morning about it too. But the Jesus Revolution movie, it's coming out, I think, February 24th. It's supposed to be in theaters everywhere. I'm going to try to get and see whoever wants to go down there Saturday afternoon. Church buy the tickets. We'll go watch the movie. And we'll see that because I feel that strong about that movie and what God's doing today. See, if you're, and I will be perfectly 100% honest with you. If you ain't hitting your knees every day praying to God, if you ain't reading your Bible every day praying to God, if you ain't searching for his path, then what right do we have to say we're a Christian? I don't think you got any. See, this cell phone I got in my pocket, and we see kids using it. Some of you's probably on it now, and I hope the kind of battery goes dead. But we got this for a reason to use, right? But we can use it for right or wrong reason. I can pull up crap on there anytime I want to, and I can pull up Jesus stuff anytime I want to. And I, hey, by the way, Facebook's a good way for me to keep up with congregation. You can't hide from old preach. But see, God's word's there for us to use every day. And I'm finding out the more I give myself to him, the more he gives me of him. See, God don't work that way. Let's say you're a child of God and you kind of drifted off path, which I did. God don't hear nothing prayers from me until I repent and get myself right with God, because he ain't going to have nothing to do with sin. You got one little sin in your life, say gossip. The devil's got you deceived thinking you're all right because of that one sin. God can't look at that. We talked about a little bit about it this morning. Today's church wants to hear all the good. I heard a dude this morning almost puke. God give you everything you need. You just be blessed by God. That's a farce. Does not work that way. See, if we got sin in our life and not living the way we did, we're gonna have some complications. And even that life's a pain in the butt. I'm just being real with you. Sometimes it's really, really good. Sometimes it's a big pain in the butt. Like this weekend, Friday, I was helping my wife. Her and her friend was in there doing all this stuff. Well, here I was carrying this box of crap tripped over the step, fell on my back, hit my hip, and I'm sitting out there like, then hit my freight train. Nobody come out to check on the Jeep. So I pull myself up, I tell Michelle's friend, I said, y'all not seen me fall on the Jeep? You fall? Michelle goes, Gang, did you fall? No, I'm good. But my neck's still sore. My back's still sore. Not all things is good in life. And a lot of times we do it to ourselves and not watching what's there. That makes sense? The devil sets up snares right in front of us that we don't even see, and we trip over them all the time. Now, if you're a God child, if you're truly saved, you've truly spiritually been reborn, your number one nemesis outside of yourself is the devil, and the devil's going to try to stop you every chance he gets. Then you got to deal with yourself. See, and y'all have heard me say this before, yourself, your flesh, is the biggest enemy you face. You can be as good as you or the worst of you, right or wrong. The way we get up and look at ourselves in the mirror every morning, if it don't line up the way Jesus says it is, then we need to pray for ourselves. I'm telling you, it's not prideful, it's not nothing. You got to pray for yourself. You got to ask God to show you the way. I can't show you the way all the time because I'm not there all the time. You got one person in your corner that's never gone. Your wife's going to be gone. Your girlfriend's going to be gone. If you got girlfriend, boyfriend, y'all need to talk to me because you're getting these BC powders and some aspirin. But guess what? God's the only one there 24/7, right or wrong. And it took me a long time to realize that because like we was talking about this morning, I had to do things my way. And I'm just being real with you. A person that has to have total control of over everything in their life, you ain't giving it to God. You still, you're a pilot. And God's a co-pilot. It don't work that way. Y'all remember bumper stickers? It used to be a long time ago. God's my co-pilot. I used to laugh at that when I was running with the devil. That person ain't got it right. He should be your pilot. Right? So this morning, it's kind of funny how the messages, you know, the message changed this morning. Cut here on the way to church, the Lord laid this verse on me, and I was like, yeah, I really need that. So we got in here and had a really good Sunday school lesson, I think, over. Everybody liked Sunday school lesson this morning?
Yeah.
I'm speaking to myself. I'm not speaking about you and your situation. But let's say I'm mad. I'm angry. I'm ready. Kurt, my brother, knows me, and some of you do. Back in the day, if I got mad at somebody, I know what I was going to do. It wasn't good. I look back at that, and my brother Kurt wasn't there all the time, but it's so many times that I could have went just that much further than I could have been in jail for murder for the rest of my life, electrocuted, or whatever, because that's the way my mind was. I'm just being honest with you this morning. I've learned to kill people with the way I thought. And I'm not getting into some of that, but it's very, very, very dark. I would get depressed. Our dad, you work. My dad never laid a hand on me physically, but he'd put that 20-pound sledgehammer in my hand, and you work. He's a workaholic. So I stay stressed out all the time. Because I knew if I didn't get it done, if this guy messed up, I was going to catch it. Everybody with me? Anybody ever been in a situation where you caught all the flack, but they didn't do their job and stuff like that? So, depressed. I've been depressed. My wife has told me, you think of the negative more than the positive. Sometimes that's true. I'm not the person that's going to look at everything and say, hey, it's all good. Not everything's all good, is it? So I was a realist. But each one of those things, I chose to stay stuck in it or not, whether it's being angry, whether it's being depressed, whether it's worrying, whether it's anything, I have a choice to choose not to do that, right or wrong. Who uses those things against you to make you not be who God created you to be? The devil, Satan, every one of those things are his tactic. And the church needs to quit buying into that. Why grab hold to something that comes from the devil? I can't quit worrying, preacher. Don't know what to do. I read on the Bible verse. I say, hey, right here it is. I still can't worry. I'm still going to worry. Can't do nothing with you. God, that's up to God, right or wrong. When we give God the credit for what God can do, then things will happen. You know what? I'm telling you right now, and I told the brother right outside, I do not think this world's going to last very much longer, and you better get your act together. If you're a true child of God, you better live up to that standard. Or if you're not, you better be finding Jesus really quick and quit playing games. Because if you just die tonight and go to hell without Jesus, guess what? That's where you're going to spend an eternity. People don't want to talk about hell. I hear this all the time. It's a hell on earth. You ain't seen squat. You know what? When you get to hell, it ain't going to be no party. It ain't going to be no good time. It's going to be by yourself with everlasting wrath of God destruction on your soul. And you ain't ever going to leave that forever. While the child of God, guess what? Goes to heaven and he lives an eternity in a place called paradise. It comes at a cost. It comes at a cost. It comes with your life. It's funny how y'all noticed how the last 3 or 4 or 5 weeks the message keeps coming back to the gospel and what Jesus done. That's the only way you get to heaven. You can't do enough good. But this morning, we kind of started off, you know, life has a way of beating us up. Right or wrong? Okay. God's used situations in my life at the time, man, I was like, man, God, don't. I shared this not too long ago, and I guess God wants me to share it again, but when my dad died, I was really upset with God, because me and my dad really started having a father-son relationship, but we didn't, but it was always like work and this type thing, and when that happened, ain't a doubt in my mind, that was the way God wanted my dad to go out. You can't change it, you can't look back at it, you can't change the situation, but I got very mad at God. Well then, the guy that helped me get over all that was my best friend, Kevin Moorhead. Kevin Moorhead got killed in an ambush a year and a half later. I was super mad at God. And I remember going up his driveway. Michelle looked at me and she said something about God. And I said, I don't even want to hear his name. Don't want to hear it. Went through all that. But guess what? Those two things helped change me and get me on my path to where I'm at today more than any two things ever. Not pleasant. It's the only thing I can do to share my walk. And then it come our granddaughter, our first granddaughter, Finley. I'm doing everything God asked me to do. You call me whatever you want to be, but I'm going to tell you something. I do what God tells me to do. And when God lays it on me, I'll do it. I'll walk into a strip club and preach Jesus. Because guess what? Who needs Jesus? I ain't a holy roller Bible pumping preacher, but I will go where God sends me, and I think he knows that. But guess what? She died, and I'm right. I mean, I'm right. I'm walking the path. But in that situation there, God revealed himself to me. Y'all have heard me say that. Some of y'all's getting sick of saying that, but we got visitors coming in. They go in and they go out. I'm telling you, in that darkest of darkest times, I felt the presence of God more than I ever felt him in my life. I don't want to lose that. And for 2 years, my life's never been the same. And like the last 3 or 4 weeks, like what I just shared, guess what? God's really grabbed a hold of me. But here's the message today. You can stay stuck in your dark dungeon all you want to. That's because you choose to. Tell me,
Remember not too long ago, the message was about staying in the cave? Huh? Y'all remember that? How many remembers that? Raise your hand. Don't lie. Got one guy. All right. Lord, I need a favor from you. Their ears are stopped up. Y'all probably remember this. Remember when David went in the cave and hid out and Saul come after him? And about how all of his men, all those that was afraid of Saul running in the cave, well, David took those guys that was afraid, hiding in a cave, and took those and turned them into warriors when they fought against Saul. And the whole thing was, when we get stuff on our mind, we put ourselves in a cave. And that cave represents depression, doubt, and everything else. We have doubt. We have doubt. How many people doubt themselves that they can do something? Don't lie. All right, we got a lot of hands going up. Hey, don't doubt. If God's in it, it's going to succeed. Or God didn't want it to happen. That's how I look at things in life. So if we go to the book of Isaiah, can anybody tell me about the prophet Isaiah before I read this? Who's Isaiah? Isaiah's man. Now, who could tell me about Jeremiah? He's the weeping what? What was that?
Weeping prophet.
God sent Jeremiah to tell his people Israel, hey, get your act together, turn back to God, he's going to bring judgment. And guess what? They tried to kill him. That's the reason why he's known as a weeping prophet. He run and hid because he was tired. He thought he was the only one. And God says, no, you ain't the only one that showed it. But God sent this man to a people to say, hey, you need to turn back to me or it's coming. Well, who's Isaiah? Somebody tell me about Isaiah. He's another message from God. I'll give you that point. So what did God send him to do? Guess what? To call the nation of Judea back to God. People's hard-headed, ain't they? Everybody's hard-headed except my wife. But listen to this. It says, his purpose to call the nation of Judea back to God and to tell God's salvation through the Messiah. Only way going to heaven is through Jesus Christ. Funny thing about it, did you catch that? When did Jesus come into the scene? The new what? Testament. So Isaiah and Jeremiah, Isaiah, which pretty much the message of the Messiah, is in the Old Testament, right? You see how the Old Testament tells about the New Testament and Jesus being the only way to salvation? Because that's part of God's plan. Now let's look at this. Let's look at David and Goliath. How many really believe David and Goliath existed? Raise your hand. Okay. How many believe all the Bible's true? Raise your hand. Well, how many of you realize that we're somewhere in a part of Revelation right now in America, the church age?
I believe it.
We're right here. Now, how many here doubt that God's going to end the world one day and heaven's going to start? Anybody doubt that? How many believe in that? Raise your hand and shout. Amen.
Amen.
So why do we mess around with stuff that don't matter? Why do we let things get us down that don't matter?
Like a camper being moved. It gets me down.
What makes you happy? Don't say a happy wife, happy life. I don't know so much there today. No, that is a fact, though. Remember that, young guys? You ever did get married, happy wife, happy life? That's a proverb. No promise. Proverbs. What really makes you happy? Somebody tell me what's something that outside of church and outside of Jesus and old church answer, what really, really makes you happy?
The innocence of
fishing? Who said fishing? All right, I got that. What was that?
Innocence of grandchildren.
Innocence of grandchildren. I got that too. What about you, young man? What makes you happy? Big cheeseburger? God, that's good. I like hearing that coming out of a young man. What else makes you happy?
I love God.
You love God? Good, great. See what I'm telling you about you young people? Tell me something that really makes you happy.
Riding my bike.
Riding your bike. There's one. See, I can get into that too. My problem is I don't like 55.
Traveling.
Camping.
Miles.
What's yours?
Music.
Turkey hunting with your dad. You know, I'll share this story with you. Where's Gavin at? Right here, sitting beside Uncle Buck.
Right here. Yeah.
Me, all right.
Awesome.
Good deal. Son, I got you something waiting. but I'll share something with your parents. Now, me and Gavin, he's sitting right here and he asked me. When he decided to play football, and I'm telling you the real deal story, Jimbo knows it. Me and Jimbo would always talk about the ball team and whatnot. Not saying we had anything to do really or not, but he come up to me his freshman year and said, Dad, I don't play high school ball. I said, you ain't playing down there. Get it. Sophomore year, he come up to Dad, I'm playing football, whether you get mad or not. I was like, oh. So, worked it out. We got down there to be a coach. First year, they was, what was y'all, 4-6? I'll be honest with you, they didn't know what winning was about. They hadn't had a winning season in like 20-something years. But then the Gulf State playoff back-to-back. Good times, great memories. Men, he'll never talk about football, do we? That cost me a lot of money to be down there to coach, but we never talk about football. We talk about the times we spend together. Yes. I remember him as a kid. I remember a time when I first came to deer hunt, guys. He gonna get embarrassed about this. But I sent him by a tree and told him to be really still. And I drawed pictures on this deer's heart right there. I said, you got to shoot him right there. Well, he's sitting there, and he was so small, he's wearing Whitney's coveralls.
Oh, Gavin. It's his birthday,
he's treating
like this.
Yeah, it is his birthday. Stand up, happy birthday, boy.
Happy birthday.
But anyway, he's moving around. I said, son, he got to be still. We're going to kill his deer. Dad, I just ain't one of them set still kind of guys. That's the way Gavin always was. He don't talk much, but when he does, it's pointed. So he gets up and he says, Dad, I got pee. We sitting up bottom of this big oak tree. I said, well, son, do your business. Well, by the time he starts, I look and I see his deer coming. I said, son, hurry up, there's deer coming. Well, he turns around, guess what he does on his leg. We sat back down, he's all ready, and I said, son, when he comes there, I said, you're going to have told us right there. But you said you told me right there. I said, forget that. I said, that white spot, if you shoot that white spot, it's about dark. I said, it ain't going nowhere. We shot. Of course, it was just there. That's the things that I remember. And that's the things I hope he remembers. So what we invest our time in, it ain't money and it ain't all done things. It's our personal time with family. That make sense? That kind of chased the rabbit. I think it's worth chasing. But if we look at Isaiah 2, it said here, it says the book of Isaiah contains both prose and poetry and uses personification, attributing personal qualities to divine beings. Also, many of the prophecies in Isaiah contain predictions that foretell a soon-to-occur event and a distant future event at the same time. Talking about the coming back of the first church. How everything's going in. But in the book of Isaiah, we can take a nugget out of that, not taking it out of context, but we can follow through. Now that's verse 1, we're in verse 40. Go back and study it, read it, do what you want to, read your Bible. I'm picking something out of verse 40 to help us today, because he shared it then. Make sense? So if you will, go down to Isaiah 40, starting at verse 27. And I had no idea this was going to be the message this morning. Until we got started. Because actually I got one for Romans 12. Who said I could preach for an hour and a half this morning?
I didn't hear anybody say that.
I bet my crackers.
What time you got to leave, Willie?
I got to leave no later than 20 after.
20 after 11.
My bill's squeezing in.
But listen to these words as I read them. And I was like, Isaiah 40. And if you're here, and if these words apply to you, I want you to raise your hand right after I read them, okay? Because we start doing some different stuff. Say, God's doing a new thing. Let me grab the glasses. Why I'm hitting so hard, you're staring ahead, I can't see. Why do you say, O Jacob, and complain, O Israel? Catch that? My way is hidden from the Lord. My cause is disregarded by my God. Do you not know? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He will not grow tired and weary, and his understanding no one can fathom. He gives strength to the weary, and increases the power of the weak. Even youths grow tired and weary, and young men stumble and fall. Now catch this verse. But those who hope in the Lord will renew their strength. They will soar on wings like eagles. They will run and not grow weary. They will walk and not faint. Who's that pertaining to this morning in church? Raise your hand. I got news for you. I got to have it every day. Every day. See, our loads get heavy just in ministry. In ministry work. Hey, somebody said it this morning, and I don't know who it was, but you're right on. I'm not at liberty to tell my wife 80% of the stuff I have, you know, tried to help people with. She's right back there, and I love her to death. Stand up, Hop Sing. Shell. Anybody ever watch Hoss Caught Right Bonanza? Little Chinese cook. Hop Sing. I love her to death, though. She can't say what she calls me in church. I say it. No, she don't. I ain't heard her say but two cuss words in her whole life, both of them with me. I think. But that ought to pertain to every one of us. Now, how many years grow weary, tired, in life, in ministry? I see people all the time involved in ministry work, they over here like this. Guess what? There's got to be some joy in what we do. If you ain't got joy in what you do for God, then I don't know about your soul. I just really don't know. You know, in America today, it seems like Christianity puts more emphasis in sports and entertainment and what they do in walking with God.
And I think that's the reason why that revival took over up there. A bunch of young people said, you know what, I ain't at all in this hip hop. I'm getting myself right with God, and the revival took over. He said kids got way too much. We got too much we're chasing. Seriously. See, I think God blesses those that does the right things, and it goes back to Beatitudes. We've got to act a certain way. And when we look at the scripture a little closer down, even the strongest people get tired at times, but God's power and strength never diminishes. He is never too tired or too busy to help and listen. His strength is our source of strength. When you feel all of life crushing you and cannot go another step, remember that you can call upon God to renew your strength. I'm going to tell you something, but you better believe it when you do it. Better believe it when you do it. We talked about it, I think, is this morning. You know, we go across that Dover Bridge over here, Paris Landing Bridge over here. How many here stop at that bridge and say, I'm going to have to look at this, make sure it holds up? How many do that? Do I got a number you can call? We go across that bridge because we got faith that bridge is going to hold us up. Right or wrong?
Right.
Now, if we did look at that bridge, and we know concrete, I'm going to go, ooh, I got this dude going to hold us up. I'd be a fool to go over that bridge, right? That's what doubt does to you. Doubt jacks you all up in the head. But when we got the faith, we just let God just do it. Give you a case of point. Y'all hear me talk about this quite a bit. We're sitting up at the pavilion one day. We hear this car screaming, and all of a sudden, that's right after I had my back surgery, and I forgot who was the first one down there. I was trying to get down there as fast as I can. It was like second or third. This dude had come down through here, running over 100 miles an hour, let go of the steering wheel, skidded across the end of the driveway, right down there in the woods, and we'll get down there. It just so happened that some of us had an interaction with this boy. When I got down there, I was like, dude, what do you think about it? He said, I just let go of the steering wheel and told God to take it. No one, that dude needs help. That's not what faith is. I'm not encouraging you to leave here and, you know, close your eyes and say, God, take the wheel and give me the parish. I don't even trust the computer trucks like that. And I'm not making fun of that young man by any means, but he had a good heart and he was going the right direction. I think something was in his way to trying to stop him. I think he got the help he needed. He's an awesome young man. I mean, I spent a lot of time with him. See, when we get depressed and down on ourselves, or anxiety builds up, or we worry, that's the crack we give the devil to come in and kick the door open to make it bigger. It's like what Shane said this morning. I love his analogy. I said, we can't sweep stuff under the rug. Shane goes, yeah, because you get a bump, you're going to trip and fall on it. That's what happens. We make excuses as another way of sweeping it under the rug. You either love God, you into God, or you ain't into God. You're either hot or you're cold. Lukewarm, it ain't going to do you no good. We all stress. We all get beat down. But guess what? God's word can lift us up, but we got to buy into it. We go through situations in life that can beat us down, right or wrong. We always got something to hang on to. I don't know about you, but a lot of times I lay down and things get a little bit on my mind. I pray, and I don't mind telling you, I get on the side of my bed just like this, and I start praying, to God, and I give it to everybody. Then when I get through, I crawl in that bed, I roll over on my side, and I talk to Jesus most of the time until I go to sleep. somebody can save them. That's just crazy. That ain't crazy to me. I've actually woke up during the night, be praying right up. I say that not to lift me up, but I say that because when we start giving our hearts to God, God knows that, and God's gonna start doing things in your life, and nobody else sits back and goes, something different about him. See, a half committed, a half lukewarm Christian is not going to change nothing. But an all in Christian, guess what? God's going to go, I'm going to use that broken vessel. Right here it says, hoping in the Lord is expecting that his promise of strength will help us to rise above life's distractions and difficulties. You know, right now, really the only thing we got is hope. What's hope, somebody? I hope this works out, excuse me. Lawson's fixing tomorrow. They got it. What's hope? Thanks, Rick. Daughter back there, mama. Oh, she was. What's hope?
Something that you want to go your way.
Something you want to go your way? You got them iPhones? Somebody pull me up the definition of hope real quick. Let's see how fast you are. Come on, teenagers. Somebody give me a word. Really, I still got 15 minutes, bro.
Building of expectation and desire for a certain thing to happen.
There you go. That's a good one. That's it. But guess what? Our hope may not always be what God wants to give us, right or wrong. But if we look at God's Word, and we understand God's Word, and we put our hope in that, then everything's going to happen. That's hope. But to me, we've had a way to change the meanings of words. Commitment. Well, the words has changed in the last three or four decades. People are not committed anymore. They're not devoted anymore. Guess what, child of God? Your commitment and devotion to God is the same today as it was when the Bible was first spoke in Genesis. That ain't changed. God don't change. We sit right here and look. He said it also means trusting in God. Trusting helps us to prepare when he speaks to us. Now, how's God speak to us, church? Here's what God don't ever talk to me. He might not be a verbal voice to you. How's God speak to you? Spirit, huh? You feel it, right? The presence of God. You know what? We're still working on it, and it's awful good this morning when we come to worship. But when we all tap in the presence of God in this church house, guess what? We're going to sing like a choir. We'll be leading Macy's Parade on Christmas Day. Let me ask you a question. How many ladies do we have up here singing this morning? Five? How many men are up here? Yeah. What was that? Hey, you come up here and show me.
Okay.
Ah, come on. Come on, I'll get you a milkshake. You come up here. Come on, son. Come up here. See, this young man, he got backbone. Now, how many men was up here singing this morning? Could you show them a sign? Zero. I ain't saying that to make man feel bad. How many young people was up here? I think it'd be kind of cool if somebody in church is standing up here.
Up there.
It wasn't nobody. What was that?
Five young people up there. There was
Five
young people.
Yes, there were.
Well, thank you for correcting me, sister. Really, really young people. But you know, I don't say that to make us feel bad. What I do say, you know, there's times I get in my walk where I don't really like, I mean, I just kind of quiet, and I understand that. Yesterday, coming back from helping the boss back there, Mr. Hebrew Slade dialed in some Christian contemporary music. I was trying to get myself all loose and happy because we was going to go eat sushi, and I was good. Sometimes I sing, sometimes I don't. But what I'm saying is, when our heart is ready to worship, that's going to come forth. Follow me? That kind of might be an indicator that we need to tap in to Isaiah 40:27-21. Because I believe when you soar like eagles, guess what? You're free. And the presence of God's going to make you sing. He's going to make you worship. But you know what the ultimate worship is? It's, I just love when God works on it. It still blows me away this day. Turn to Romans 12. This was the original message. I'll try to speak this up real quick. I'll put that Baker 6-speed in full throttle. Motorcycle guys don't want to talk about that. So what is Romans 12 when you look down at that? What is it, Mo?
Bodies of living sacrifice.
Bodies of living sacrifice. Can you see how that Romans 12:1 would tie into Isaiah? Now picture this. We Christians up here, we're soaring like eagles. We ain't weary, right? I love watching eagles, by the way. So we up here soaring. And guess what? I don't think you soar until your bodies become a living sacrifice to God, because that's the eagles. That makes sense? And you have a choice to be a buzzard or an eagle. A buzzard just circles, the eagle just gone. Father, free spirit. That's our country's emblem. I mean, it ain't about freedom. But when we read this in Romans 12:1, it says, therefore, I urge you, brothers, in the view of God's mercy, to offer your bodies a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. Each one of you and myself today, some point in time, whether it's tonight, we need to study what holy means. Because it's been throughout the door. I think we need to come to the understanding of what holiness is and pursue that. And pleasing to God. This is your spiritual act of worship. You know what? You can come to church, you can sing to these rafters rattle and have the most angelic voice ever, but the single most important act of worship you can do is how you live your life for God. Case in point. That's it. That's number uno. But the church has kind of flip-flopped, thinking it's all about the light shows and entertainment and all. It ain't about that. There's people in a world that needs change. And the only way we can change them is be who God created us to be. Now, a buzzard is set perched in a tree and not move. An eagle might sit in that perch a little while to rest, but he's always looking for what?
Food.
Eagle looks for a lost soul. Is this all making sense? I ain't losing nobody. Trying to tie this all in together. You understand it, young man? You understand it, I'm good. Get this. Verse 2, do not conform any longer to the pattern of this world. You know what's tripping a lot of Christians up? They still in the pattern of the world. One reason I ask what makes us happy, there's nothing wrong with chasing happiness. But guess what? You better have God's order in it where it needs to be. Then he will bless you with that time. Pattern of the world's tripping a lot of people up, and I literally think it's going to send a lot of people in church that thought they had it right that don't, straight to the gates of hell. Because when we are Christian and we view the pattern of the world, it's a whole lot different than the pattern of the kingdom of God. How is the people out there going to know that until we go share that with them? That make sense? Everybody with me? It says, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind. How do we renew our mind? God's word, right? We hang around believers. I'll be honest with you. Part of my job is helping out everybody at spiritual levels. And the Bible even says if this person's weak in their faith, I'm supposed to hold them up and encourage them in the same ways. And we do that. But we don't look at people's, say like if I'm struggling and y'all look down at me for that, that's going to continue my struggles. We're supposed to help people up. And when we start renew our mind, guess what? I hear this all the time. I can't stand that person. How many's heard a Christian say that, by the way? Raise your hand. See, that's the problem we get into because of the hypocrites. The hypocrite. You know what I've got to start, and I don't mean it in a bad way. I kind of go up and I go, that kind of hypocrite, ain't it? How do they know they're doing wrong unless somebody corrects them, right? I'm not being a real pain in the butt. But guess what? They never know that until their mind's transformed to love that person. Even though they might have shafted them in a business deal or whatever, you still prayed for that person. The only way you're going to do that is by the transformation of the Holy Spirit of your mind through the Word of God. Loose lips sink ships. I know a bunch of reporters in the church house too. Channel 5, if they ever get a job, open them and send them my application. Tongues can be the work of the devil. A lot of times they are. So think about that. The transformation of your mind, then you will be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. Now those two verses really jump out at me. It tells me a lot. Tells me a lot about our walk. So somebody tell me what Romans 12, 1 and 2 does for you. Then I'm going to blow through the next part. What's it mean, somebody? Is a half committed heart going to be able to achieve that? No. Takes everything. Takes everything. But I want to show you something. We're going to skip down to verses 9 through 21. Billy, I'm going to get you done, I think, just about nine. Billy said, when I get up, walk out, don't think of you done anything wrong, because I got to go meet a guy 20 after 11. So if you see him get up, I don't make it, and he gets up and walks out, and he's mad. Jerry, give him a big hug. Say, I love you. I want to show you something in a few verses. I kind of seen this other day, and I'm like, man, that's pretty cool. Without love, you ain't nothing. And I'm not talking about you getting love. I'm talking about your soul being all about loving people. So if you have a problem with somebody today, I'm going to ask you to come to the altar right after I get through this message and pray to God and take that away, because you know what? You're still holding unforgiveness in your heart. Grudges is an unforgiveness in the heart, and you're stopped growing. You ain't going nowhere. And I'm going to share this for you with you. You know, this past
summer, I think it was, fall, I went down to Walford's down there, and I said, hey, we just want to change some landscaping. I told them, I said, hey, I want something that the deer ain't going to eat. So they sold me these bushes that the deer resisted. I don't know if it worked or not. I seen one eating off one in front, and they left alone, so maybe it's 50-50 thing. But I planted those shrubs, and I have this house ivy that I shelled to you. It's been there for years, and it finally got up where it's beautiful, and all in the trees, and all around life work. Well, guess what? The cold temperatures we had in December killed them all. These are brown. I hope to go back. It's going to take a miracle, but I think they're dead. What really got me was the vines, because I baby them things, you know. Same stuff we got up there. I ain't looked up. That's probably dead, too. But maybe God bring them back. I told you this. When your heart gets cold, your soul dies. It gets stony. I pray that God gives us a heart of flesh to love the unlovable today. But listen to this. I won't go through it as quick as I can. Starting in verse 9, it talks about love. Don't you keep up with how many times he gives us a command or do this. Starting in verse 9, love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fire or fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, it is mine to avenge, I will repay, says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. In doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. What about that? If it's commands or whatever, if he's telling us to do something, how many did he give us in like 13 verses? How many?
30.
And some of us think we can walk and talk and say whatever we want to about anybody, just do all this when God's word sitting there telling us if we got this love, that all caters in love. You can come to church and say, I love. But if you can't forgive somebody, that's not love. If you can't be humble, if you're proud, how can that be love? You see what I'm saying? How it all ties in together? It's a discipline. Some's willing to pay the price, some ain't. See, it's my job to coach everybody to wrap it and grab it and say, hey, change me. Send me. use me. If you're here today with every head bowed, with every eye closed, hey, you got something to give God today, hey, make this altar your own. Don't worry about what people think. Don't worry about what people will do. Because, hey, I thought that my whole life. Until I just said, hey, God, here it is. Use me. If you're here today and you need to accept Jesus Christ as Savior and Lord and have your sins just wiped away, hey, what better day today than today? Huh? See, here's my thing. I want you to have the final assurance you know where you're going when you leave this place. See, I'm all about having a good time. I'm all about living it up. But I want to do it God's way. I want to do it God's way. If you're here today and you just need to turn it all over to God, hey, this altar's open. I'm going to tell you something, and you listen to me. A lot of times we don't come to the altar because, number one, it ain't pushed in different churches. But it's something about when you humble yourself in front of people and lay it right out there for God to see, guess what? He going to do something. That's just how it works. Maybe you got a problem in your marriage. Maybe somebody's got some health issues you need to pray about. Maybe it's not you need to pray about. Maybe you need to come up here at this altar and pray about somebody today. I'm going to tell you something. If there's somebody that's popping in your head right now, you ought to be up here praying for them. It ain't about being comfortable. This is about giving it to God and getting your life right with God. That's what changes people. That's what changes life. And I'm going to put it to you like this. If you ain't got nothing to pray for the revival that's going on. Pray that the revival catches fire and moves all the way across this country. So I'm going to tell you something, folks. I don't know about you, but I keep up with the times. I believe in the gift of discernment. And I don't like what I see heading for this country. So you better pray up. Pray for your kids. Pray for your grandkids. If you're here today and you need to talk to me after church, hey, I'm here. You need to talk to me right now, I'm here. But this is my desire for you today. Hey, open your hearts to God and let God move in you in a mighty way. Each one of us is born for a time like this. I'm just telling you. I've had a few talks with God. Hey, God, why didn't you put me back 200 years ago in the mountains where a grizzly bear or Indian might be mine? Biggest foe. Guess what? Time's now. If you're here today and you have a doubt about your life, hey, just seek God to find the answers for that. Just seek God to find the answers for that. Dear Father God, we just want to lift our hearts to you, dear Father God. We just want to thank you for who you are. We just want to thank you for the blessings you give us each and every day, dear Father God. We just want to thank you for who you are and what you do. We just want to lift you up and be your people. We just love you and thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. All right, I'm going to do something real quick. Bro Mark, you come up here, please. He's a good friend of mine. He's a friend of my brother's, and we rode the Gulf Shores. And he's going through some stuff, and I believe in the power of prayer. I believe his brother needs some prayer, needs some uplifting. The Lord's working on him, I can tell you that. So if you come up, let's get around him. Let's pray for him real quick, and if we can stop that video, God's going to do something here today.